Well, hello, Crosswinds. Welcome back to the Crosswinds Church More Than Sunday podcast. Glad you're joining us today. We are doing something special. We have got our children's ministry director, Josh Peine. He's going to be talking to us a little bit about the incredible creative content that they have been making for our services for our children on Sunday mornings. In fact, here's my recommendation. If you don't have kids or you've not yet been watching their videos, before you listen to the rest of this podcast, go on YouTube, go to their Crosswinds Kids YouTube channel, and just watch like two or three of the very creative videos they've done, and then come back to the podcast and listen to him explain how they did them. Enjoy this. We are here with Josh Peine, who's our children's ministry director, Crosswinds Kids director. Josh, thanks for coming on the podcast today.
What's going on, everybody? Thanks for having me.
Yeah, man. I've got to tell you, everyone, I have been more impressed with the content that Josh is putting out every single week than the content that I'm putting out.
Wow.
It's so creative. And I thought we could talk about that a little bit. But before we do all that, how are you and your family holding up with all of this? What's it like? You guys have a baby and you are doing shelter in place life. What's that like?
Yeah, I mean, me and Katrina are fine. The kids are going a little crazy. Henry's protesting. He keeps trying to escape out the front door. We also don't have a mask big enough for him yet, so he's really getting the short end of the stick.
Yeah.
So, no, it's been we're doing fine. We're very fortunate enough to live somewhere where there's a little bit of property that we can roam around, and so we're not so constrained to a little box. Right. So that's been nice.
Yeah, that's a good thing. That's a good. Now, do you you are just what I know about you. You are a people person. Like you like to be around people.
Yeah.
Has this been hard for you to work on a staff of one by yourself in children's ministry right now and to not have families, kids, parents, volunteers around?
Oh, it's been incredibly hard. Like, I mean, in all honesty, it's been rough. I am, my wife calls me a pack animal. And so like, there've been days where she's called me. I've been, you know, it's been like 1 o'clock and she'll call me and she can just tell from my voice. She's like, you need to come home. You need to be around people.
Yeah.
Cause she knows I get, I mean, I that normally I'm a pretty upbeat guy, pretty happy guy. And if I ever do slide into, you know, some minor depression, it's typically when I'm by myself or I'm isolated for long periods of time. So,
yeah. And the thing, just so everybody is clear on this, Josh lives with his family out on our church property. So he has the ability to go actually into the office every day while most people are working from home.
Yeah.
His office is like across the grass from his house. So just makes sense to walk over there and do the work rather than try to do it in his house with a baby and a toddler. And
yeah, there's no way I could get anything done with a 3-year-old and a 5-month-old running around or running amok. So I come over here and I stay in my office and I stay in my bathroom and I Lysol the heck out of everything just in case somebody else comes. But
right.
Yeah, this is the way that it seems to be working for me.
And you actually, you know, it's funny because most people are in this moment right now where they're on the opposite end, Josh. They're like, get me out of my house and let me go be alone. I cannot get alone to save my life.
Yeah.
And you're in that spot where you're spending a lot of every day alone right now, at least your work days.
Yeah, the work days alone, and when you work for a church, especially when you work in a department like kids ministry, where you're so used to being around just huge mobs of people. I mean, I find that I'm much more efficient with my time. There's less things to distract me, but I mean, part of the fun of this job is all the fun distractions that come along with it.
So. Yeah. Well, you've been putting a lot of your time into the actual creative content and creating some really cool, like teachable videos, teaching videos for Sunday mornings. And I was hoping we could talk about them. I mean, so just to walk everyone through, if you don't have kids and you've not been watching these, the first week, Josh built this kind of Lego building and taught from right behind it, right? Was it a wall? Were you doing like Nehemiah story or something like that?
Yeah, we were talking about Nehemiah building the wall, or when he went back to Jerusalem and tried to rebuild the wall and what his game plan for that was.
Yeah.
So
and that was cool. That was cool and engaging and interesting because here you were with these Legos around you. But then the next week, you took it to a whole nother level. Like, it was, you can go on YouTube and watch these. The Crosswinds Kids has their own YouTube channel. And this is you telling, I believe, the Joshua and the Israelite story crossing the River Jordan into the Promised Land, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And what did you do?
So we, a whole lot of this process has been, okay, what story do I want to tell? And then how can I tell it without an audience or without a, you know, without any people to help me, aside from my wife, who has been a lifesaver in this? And then how do you make it creative and exciting enough that kids and their parents are going to want to watch it? So I used to do these whiteboard videos as like a side job where I would, I don't know if you watch the old UPS advertisements on TV where it would be like a whiteboard and they would tell a story about UPS through this whiteboard. And I thought, well, that's kind of fun. I've got a whiteboard. Let me try to do this. And so I got a friend who had a camera and we set it up and did this, not realizing that UPS was doing it all digitally with, you know, in After Effects and post-production, and they weren't actually drawing on a board at all. Right. I've always had a little bit of a talent in writing and visually spacing stuff out. And so I used one of the big whiteboards that we had here on campus, and I plugged the camera in and just filmed myself essentially write out and draw the story of Joshua taking the Israelites across the Jordan River. And then my wife thankfully went back and edited it and cut it up, and we played it forward in sped up time, like 20 times the normal speed, and it looked pretty cool.
Yeah, man. It was. So how long did it take you to write all of that? There was an incredible amount of drawing is the better word probably for it than writing.
Yeah. So the hardest part is not like the drawing itself is very simple. When you look at it, you go like, oh, that couldn't have taken that long. The problem is you have to do it all in pretty much one take, or it doesn't look right when you go back and try to speed it up.
Yeah.
So that took me the better part of 2 days. Wow. So I'm wearing the same outfit 2 days in a row for continuity's sake. Yeah. But by the time you frame it up with the camera and you get the camera in the same spot on the table and you hit record and you make sure everything lines up and you have enough room to do the next scene and all that fun stuff. Yeah. Like it took the better part of 2 days and then probably twice as long to edit it.
Right.
So
yeah, I'm sure there was a lot that went into that. So, and then you sped it up by how much? What did you say?
It's between 15 and 20 times the normal speed.
And then you did a voiceover on top of that, telling the story that went with the illustrations that you had kind of been drawing on the whiteboard.
Yeah. So then I had to go back and I had to try to tell the story as it was appearing on the screen. So then there was that whole fun part too.
So here's the really cool thing. Josh puts this up and it's great. I watch it with my kids, even though I don't have a kid in your ministry. We watch it together as a family. It's pretty fun. And then you told me later that week, like other churches started, like what, how did that all go down? Somebody contacted you?
So the first thing that happened is I made the video. I put it up on our website. I put it up on our Facebook page, our YouTube page. And then I'm a part of a couple of kid ministry like groups on Facebook that, you know, people talk about what they're doing and what's happening and all that fun stuff. And I thought, like, I'm just going to put this video up there just in case there's anybody out there who's in a worse place than Crosswinds is. Like, they don't have either any time or any hours or any money or any resources. And I thought, I'll just put it up there and they can download it and use it if they want to. And then I checked back a couple hours later and it had somewhere like, man, I don't remember what the stages were, but it got really popular really fast.
Yeah.
And the next day I got contacted by two different, ministry curriculum groups that wanted to like feature it on their app. And one of them wanted to feature it on the website.
Yeah.
And so then I had to kind of scramble to like get all that stuff together and make sure that, you know, it would work for them. And so, yeah. So, last time we checked, that one has close to 5,000 views across all the platforms that we have it up on. It got shared like 400 times on Facebook, and only like 100 times was me. So,
yeah, dude. No, it's a really good video. It's well done. Okay, so then the next week, you topped it even more, in my opinion. Like, I looked at it and like I just was, my jaw dropped. I was amazed. You somehow, and you can explain that you're, oh man. So the downside of being a non-professional podcaster is you can be in the middle of a podcast like we are right now and the neighbor starts up his lawnmower. So sorry, everybody. You're going to hear the sound of a Honda push lawnmower right now that I'm looking at out my window. Okay.
I think that'll add some soothing ambiance. It'll give everybody a real dose of reality. I like it.
Actually, so. Now that I'm looking at it, it's not him. It is somebody breaking the shelter in place law. And it's his paid lawnmower guy who came. Interesting. All right.
Whoops.
I'm not one to turn anybody in. I look the other way. I'm all about looking the other way.
I wouldn't be opposed if somebody came and mowed my lawn, so I wouldn't turn them in either.
No
so
doubt.
Okay. Maybe you should just do that. Just go, you're a turn the other way guy. I'm more of a low-key blackmail guy. I would go out and go, I won't call anybody if you do my lawn too.
I read that it's like $1,000 of a fine if they catch a residential landscaper or gardener coming and mowing your lawn. I read this.
Really?
Yeah.
Who gets the fine? The residential owner or the lawnmower?
Right. That's the question. That's a great question. I think these neighbors skipped town because I have not seen them in a month since the shelter in place thing went down. And my hunch is that they saw it coming, knew they were not going to be able to work or do anything else for a while, and just figured, let's go elsewhere, which don't we all wish we could have been. Right.
I was going to say, if it's the if it's the person who lives there that has to pay that fine, I'm just going to go start mowing the lawns of people I don't like.
Right, right. Okay. So go on. I was saying this great video. So you have clothing that somehow, like socks and shirts and jackets, like pants, that takes the form of people in a stop motion animation video that tells a story. What in the world was this thing?
So this was, I can't take credit for a bulk of this because it is outside my realm of artistry. So I met a few people who work, or who are in charge of a couple of studios that put out ministry content for a couple of the big curriculum writers. I had met them at a conference in Nashville, and we had talked about doing some projects together, and we had a couple of ideas. And I hadn't heard from him in probably 6 months. And then when this thing kind of hit, I just kind of reached out to him and said, like, hey, if you guys are looking to do any big projects or you guys want to try anything and you guys need help, let me know. I'd love to be a part of it in some way, shape, or form. And so then I was a part of like this kind of brainstorming email chain with them. And they were talking about doing something for Easter that, you know, we could make widely available to a lot of churches. And so they put together in their studio this awesome like stop motion video representation of the Easter story, and then sent it over to me to do some editing to it and then to do the voiceover for it. Yeah. And then they sent it out and offered it to any church that it essentially went out to a lot of the curriculum subscribers as like a free tool. Like, hey, if you don't have a way to tell the Easter story, like use this.
Do you have any idea how many people used it?
I have no clue. And I wanted, they're like, hey, we even talked about like, hey, if we copyright or contract, I'm like, nope, I don't want any of that. Like, I'll do it. I'll send it back to you and you guys can do all of that stuff. I just want to help.
Just to describe it to everybody, this thing is so amazing. It is like, just picture Gumby with clothing instead of clay, right? I mean,
yeah. Yeah. So like Jesus is a really nice pressed, like wrinkle resistant button down shirt,
right?
With a purple scarf. And then they use, all the disciples are different colored shirts. And then my actual favorite is Pilate is an iron.
Right.
Like he's just a plug in iron that is, you know, condemning. And the angry mob of people and the angry religious people are black socks, which I thought was pretty hilarious.
Right. It's incredibly creative. So, I watched it and my first thought was, how does Josh have all this clothing in his closet? I've never seen him wear these things. Now I understand you doing it, Bart. My wife turned to me, and this is not a knock on you. This was meant to be. And Kurt, she goes, Josh, this is like while we're watching it. She's like, he is in the wrong industry.
Thanks.
You're a great children's director. So that was not meant to be that, but she just like if he has the talent to do stop motion animation with clothing, he should be doing that full time. It was pretty incredible, dude. It was really, really great.
the cool thing is in working with them, like now I know how to do that. And I actually have all of the stuff that we need to do that.
Yeah.
It is the amount of time and editing prowess. Like I can edit a video. It takes me four times as long as it'll take somebody who knows what they're doing.
Right.
So I'm all about these partnerships, but it was a lot of fun to work on and make, and we're pretty happy with the finished product. So,
yeah, no, that's good. That's good, man. This weekend, I have not had a chance to watch it yet. What did you end up doing this last weekend?
So we got through the Easter thing, and I think our feeling was we wanted to get back into kind of a normal routine. And so we did much more, kind of what we would do on a Sunday morning. And we thought, what a great time to let the kids and let the families get involved and just let them ask questions. My teaching style, especially with the kids, is very, very give and take.
Yeah.
I ask them a lot of questions. I let them respond. I let them be a part of the story every Sunday.
Yeah.
And so I was missing a little bit of that. And so
somebody we are doing a question to you this week. Is that what happened?
What's that?
Somebody submitted a question to you this week. Is that what happened?
Yeah. So I reached out to the families. I said, like, hey, what questions do your kids have about faith, about church, about the Bible, or about God? And I'm going to answer them kind of live. Like I'm going to draw them out of a bowl, and whatever question I get, I'm going to try to answer it for them.
Yeah.
And then I'll throw some creative stuff in there too. So like this week, one of the questions that we got was, like, how do we know that God is real if we can't see him? And I thought, what a wonderful opportunity to blend two things that I love, science and God. And so I called my buddy Eric, who works over at the laboratory, and was like, let's have a conversation about, you know, Eric, let's have a conversation like from a science perspective, from a very practical perspective, and try to answer this question about God. And so we talked about how evidence works in science, and how a lot of times when you're trying to discover something or you're trying to figure something out, like you have to set up these tests to look for evidence. And so Eric did a cool little at-home science experiment that they can do. And yeah, we just talked about, like, how do we know things are real if we can't see them, like gravity or air or, you know, or God?
It's so funny to me that I know, Eric, you're right. And it's so funny to me that you got asked a question and you had a person on call. So here's the thing we all know about Josh on staff. Josh has got a guy for everything. He's got a guy. So Christmas comes along and we're thinking about using a live reindeer in our service. And we're like, how are we going to find a live reindeer? And somebody goes, reach out to Piney. I bet he's got a guy. And sure enough, within like 2 days, you had a line on a reindeer for us if we wanted it. Everything.
Yeah, it took me one phone call and I had a reindeer guy, which is cool to know. Like, I have a reindeer guy if I ever need one. So
everything we ever come up with, you've got a guy. Magic, you got a guy. Painting, you got a guy. Anything, you got a guy. So no surprise that you had a guy then for Sunday. And
somebody once told me when I was younger, like, in business, it's not about what you know, it's about who you know. And I just kind of took that to heart and thought, like, well, shoot, if I'm going to be successful, I'm just going to meet everybody I possibly can. I am still waiting to hear back from another friend of mine, and I can't say who it is, but there may or may not be a professional athlete featured on one of our videos coming up soon. I hope we can swing it and make it work. We'll see. But yeah, I'm throwing every angle I can at this thing to keep the kids excited and to keep the parents engaged and just to, I don't know, have some fun in this highly stressful, highly closed off world that we live in right now.
I think that's great, man. That's really, really great. Well, dude, thanks for coming on this thing today and talking to us. And more than anything, thank you for putting all of this creativity into our kids and means to keep them engaged in this time. I mean, I would imagine, especially doing video content, in some respects, it's a harder time than ever because, let's face it, a lot of them are watching video content all day long, right? So for them to right now have an opportunity to have your content and have it to be as good as it is, it's really important. So thanks for it, man.
Ah, thank you. No, it's a pleasure. I love doing it. And then, you know, it's fun just to see all the new stuff that we can come up with. Like, I think sometimes, you know, we get so used to a routine, and it's nice to have it shaken up every once in a while. And so that's what we're trying to do with these videos, like to keep them engaging and to keep it focused on what's important. But also to make it different than we've probably seen before from a church. So,
yeah. No, that's true. I agree with you. All right. Well, good. Thanks, Josh. Appreciate it, man. Have a great afternoon.
All right, Chris, I got another video to edit, so I'll talk to you later.
See you, buddy. Bye.
All right. Bye.